Yeah, there's an outline in the whole memo that talks about the goal would be to have changes prepared for fall town meeting with the idea of putting it on the ballot for March, right? So that would be to get started as soon as possible so that you have changes ready for fall town meeting.
Do you think that's, Betsy, do you think that's realistic?
Yes, I do, but I think that that is for the charter, and I, what we did ten years ago was then we followed that with the bylaws in hand, because the bylaws can be approved at town meeting, they don't have to be.
They don't have to be on the ballot.
So hopefully they'd be done by the spring. If they weren't, you could give them a fall town.
So the charter is what you tackle first, and then.
That was what we've done in the past.
Yeah, and then that gives you a lot of big cushion for the bylaws, which you need.
And the hope, I think, for the charter in light of the assessor's reorganization would be to have that done for the fall, because we're currently in limbo until that's codified.
Questions from other selectmen?
I'll go. Well, first of all, thank you all for being interested in this committee. It's so important and probably one of like the least glamorous committees.
Most glamorous.
The most, it's the most glamorous committee.
You're going to lose them.
Okay. But I appreciate the enthusiasm. So we have a bunch of several of you who have done this before, either once or more than once. And so I'm going to address this question to the newbies in the audience and just say the charter in particular, when I go to talk to the Boy Scouts and the Girl Scouts, I explain it's sort of like our constitution, right? This is the structure of our government, and it's evolved over time to meet the needs as we've evolved. And some of the changes and the issues that the committee will have to deal with are sort of longstanding things and philosophical things and ways that we could do things better that require you to know a little bit of how we've done things in the past. So my question to the folks who haven't been on this committee before would be, especially if you're relatively new to town like Bob or like John, how would you familiarize yourself with what the issues are around this charter and what changes you might consider making, considering that this will be pretty new territory for you? So you can just go that way.
So I was going to ask something like that, which is, you know, what is there by way of, you know, what I call legislative history from the past, not the old, I know what I don't know. And I don't want to keep my mouth shut and listen for a while because I don't. So, one, I'm assuming there's going to be a certain degree of institutional knowledge, which is great. But I'm wondering, is there anything, you know, formalized from the past committees reflecting, okay, we changed that here, or we considered and did not change it? As I said, sort of like legislative history. I would hope so, and two, I would also think that going forward something like that is also helpful if we haven't done it. I guess the short answer is just to try to absorb that and not take the attitude, well, I just got here, let me tell you what you guys ought to be doing, because I've been on enough boards, you know, when I've been one of the guys who's been on for a long time, to sort of roll my eyes when I hear that kind of reaction, say, just wait.
Mr. Schwaltz.
I think probably you're going to have public hearings, which will allow people in the town to suggest what items, where they've had problems within the structure of the community. I have learned since I've come here that Bedford is a very well-run town. There may not be that many things, but one of the issues could be term limits. I don't know whether there's been any discussion about that. That is more and more in our body politic, as we've seen in national government and other areas, careers in government, and the difficulty with incumbency and with new people, fresh blood being able to come into the town. I have no idea whether there's been any discussion on that or not, but it seems to me that's one of the issues. But I'm going to add something here. I'm here because I was inspired by the town manager. She appeared at Carlton Willard. And I ran out the door, and I file this. I have had some misgivings after this. I'm going to tell you that I would like to withdraw my reconsidered. Partly, I didn't know whether you'd have five people that would be willing to come, and it is something that interests me. But I anticipate that I'm very welcome to come to a public meetings and give you my thoughts and all. But I listened to some of the people here on the road and others, and I feel the charter would be very, committee would be in very good hands with any of five.
Those are the shortest term limits.
Wow. Wow, we can still hang out.
She'll be back to get you for something else. She's coming back.
See you later.
Well, thank you for rounding out the field. Maria, do you want to take a stab at the question?
So I think just a lot of listening. I'm new to this type of thing, and it interests me, but I think a lot of listening and asking questions and seeing how things were done before gives me an opportunity to come in as sort of an impartial person, knowing the town a little bit and not having an opinion on anything either way. So I tend to be good at that type of thing, coaching high school girls for years and managing a bank where we have, you know, very strict guidelines and federal regulations. I understand that perspective, but I'm also able to sort of figure how people's emotions play into things and listen and just learn from the people that are already experienced in this stuff. It's a learning curve for me, but I am very interested. So.
Thank you.
So I guess the only other thing, and I am the liaison to the Volunteer Coordinating Committee, but one thing that I will say is anybody who has thought to come here for this committee, was there a reason why you chose this over other committees that have openings and boards that have openings? Was it something particular about this? And if you're not chosen for this, would you be open to looking at what other openings we have? Good pitch, right, Kara?
Yeah, very good pitch. There are a lot of openings on a lot of committees.
Yes.
I'm fascinated by reading charters and bylaws and statute and all of this. So I find it very interesting. I don't think a lot of changes are necessary with our charter, but I think there are a few areas that we can look at. I think there may be more in the bylaws, just tweaking things to make them clearer or, in terms of the intent. But that's why I did it. I also volunteered because I didn't know how many people had signed up, but I'm not going to withdraw my name. I would very much like to be on it, and I hope that my saying that I someday will serve on BCC, it's not going to be next week, Caroline, if you don't pick me. But I love serving the town. I've done it over the years, as everybody in this room has. And I will, if it's not BCC or this, it'll be something else in the future,
mm-hmm.
I'm sure.
Okay.
I actually didn't realize there were other openings. I'm open to any of them. I just wanted to start to try to get involved. And if there's something else that you think I'm better suited for, I'm open to that. But this is the one that popped up on the page when I was on it, so I didn't realize.
Good to know.
Yeah, well, once you're sitting in that seat, like, we're already thinking.
Yeah. I've got a lot of free time.
You won't after you just said that. I think this is the dry reading, and it's interesting. I know of serving on that committee and doing it for the schools, it is quite dry to go through and read all of that. So the type of, and the number of meetings and the words that you parse over. So you do have to have a real desire to want to do this. And I think that's what we've heard from all of you is it is a task that does require some real effort to get through. So I thank you for coming out and applying.
Anybody else? It is an impressive lineup. our practice has been to deliberate at the end of the meeting. And if everyone in agreement with that, you're welcome to stay throughout the rest of the meeting, but I guess that since summer all of you will be appointed, there is a routine that takes place in terms of all committee appointments that many of you have heard before, specifically issues such as compliance with the open meeting law, which obviously the Charter and Bylaw Review Committee is subject to, posting meetings, the taking the minutes. There's the whole question of civil discourse and how we conduct business. It'd be very unusual for a Charter and Bylaw Committee meeting to be disrupted by anybody or anything, but civil discourse is our middle name in terms of government here. We hope that another point that is made is rotating chairs, but I don't think that needs to be said for this. It's a limited time frame, and I presume we'll have one chairperson. And I guess you'll be subject to taking the state ethics test, which is online, and it's a good exercise. I don't usually... I heard Mark Siegenthaler do this for about 10 years, and after a while I stopped listening to him. Am I missing anything?
Civil discourse. Leadership, open meeting.
Yeah.
Oh, just
ethics.
There's an ethics test, but the open meeting thing, we always just point out, you can't communicate via email with your committee members, because that's a violation of the open meeting law. Anything that you deliberate about has to be done in a publicly noticed meeting that is in a public building and public can attend. So you can schedule your meetings, you can share an interesting article from the Boston Globe, but you cannot discuss anything amongst yourselves on email. So that's the one thing, if you're new to town government, that sometimes people get caught up, that they don't realize that you can't do that. So it's important.
There will be representatives of the selectmen, the school committee, the planning board, and of course the moderator. And as soon as those appointments are made, we hope that the review committee will be able to get started. But we'll let you know, welcome to stay to the end, or we'll let you know very soon that what the outcome is in terms of our own selection. Anybody else?
No, and just to reiterate, if by chance you're not chosen, go to the Volunteer Coordinating Committee website and find something else that interests you.
And not that I'm discouraging folks from staying, because if you'd like to, you should, but be advised that it wouldn't be taken up until about 8:45. But I'm happy to follow up with you first thing tomorrow to let you know.
Thank you.
Thank you all for coming.
Thank you.
Thanks. If you see Selectman Moonen.
Stand in back
there. Yeah. And we just have to remember to double back.
Yeah.
Okay.
It's on my radar, Margaret.
Okay. Good. That's a major
message. Are the folks here from VHB?
Yeah, so the folks are here from VHB. We'll just wait till.
Aww.
Oh, sweet. Carlton Miller's the best.
Yeah. He was on community preservation a couple of years in the housing community. He volunteered with the CBC team.
Sure. Mike, do we want to wait for Bill?
Yeah, I mean, we're happy to continue, and Bill, you know, Bill might have gone out for a snack. Is there a anything on the?
Yeah, they're in the hallway. We're just getting them now.
Oh. Bring coffee.
How many people are up? No, there's no public comments. It's just a refresh on the previous presentation for selectmen that haven't seen it before. There's been no changes since the last meeting.
On this?
There'll be a meeting in May.
I don't know.
Yep.
Eight times.
But we'll do. I'll do a whole update. Okay. We need to move. We can.
That's fine.
Are we moving?
Not yet, I don't think.
Okay.
CH see who else comes.
Okay.
Looks okay so far.
Hey, Dave.
Mr. Yon?
Text her. Okay. Oh, you could go
Joe and a tie. Joe and a tie.
I don't know why.
I'm running low on mints. Okay, so I think we'll get started.
All right, well, if everybody's ready.
Stay on top. Hoping everyone's ready.
A little quiet. The next item on the agenda is a discussion about the Minuteman Bikeway extension.
Do you want to get some order? Okay. So, before us tonight is the Minuteman Bikeway Extension refresher. So I want to be clear on a couple things before we start, because we are approaching the 25% design phase. VHB and DPW are happy to answer questions if there are questions tonight, but the opportunity, and I'm talking sort of more major substantive questions, the opportunity for more substantial public input will take place in May when the 25% design review has been completed and MassDOT will be back out with VHB and DPW. The main reason for refreshing on this is it has been a while since everyone has met and talked about this project. We've had selectmen who are currently on the board who are not able to see the presentation. So what you're seeing tonight, you most likely have seen before. There have been no substantial changes made to the bikeway extension design status. But I just want to reiterate, this is not a public hearing. We are not looking for input at this time on the project or changes. It's strictly to do a refresher for all in the audience in anticipation of the May meeting, but also to give specifically the selectmen a refresh on the project as we come up to the next phase in May.
David? Thank you. Just to say a few words briefly, we have here a presentation tonight for those folks who may not have been involved in the project since its beginning. I think 2008 yes. is when it started. And it's moved along over the years. We've reached a significant milestone, which is the town manager said is the 25% design. And through the MassDOT process, 25% is generally when the design is somewhat firmly in place. Issues such as right of way are resolved. And so we've gotten there. There's been a lot of work from the consultant and others over the years. It is on the tip, so it is scheduled for federal funding, for full construction funding for the year 2022. So the next step through the DOT process is this 25% design hearing that is tentatively planned for late spring. Because it's been a number of years, certainly predating my time as well, we just wanted to give a refresher for everybody to remind them about the extent of the project, the scope, where it's going, and then if there are general questions that people have, clarification requests, we're happy to answer those as well.
But this, just to sort of reiterate, and I know we're sort of harping on the point, but to be clear about the process and our say and oversight in the process, what you're seeing is not an update, so there have been no substantial changes, as I said, but also the real true time for public input will be in May. So the hope of this is to give sort of refresh everyone's mind on the project in front of us in anticipation of the upcoming public meeting in May.
So with us today are Trish Domigan, Senior Municipal Manager at VHB, as well as Pete Sorensen, the Project Manager for the project, and Trish will be giving the presentation.
Thank you, David. Hello.
Hello.
How's everyone doing? So Pete and I have been working on this project since 2008, and there's been a lot of iterations to this. Originally, what we did was a feasibility study to take a look at the cross-section and whether or not a hard surface or a soft surface, something like a asphalt surface or stone dust would be feasible for the town. It went to town meeting, I believe, in 2010. From that point, we took a look at different alternatives for the project in terms of what the best bike accommodation could be from where it ends right now at Depot Park at the intersection of South at Loomis, going up to Concord Road. There's been a series of iterations where ultimately it now goes to the Concord Town Line. So as David had mentioned, just going to give you kind of like a reminder of what we, what the project is and what the sequence, what the design is for the project.
Might be a scroll on the mouse.
So MassDOT approved the project back in 2014 so that it's viable for state and federal funding. Right now it's $6.8 million for the construction. It is on the tip year, as David had said, for 2022. It's going to take about a year and a half for construction. That's just based on what we feel the construction sequencing is going to be. The project is about 2.2 miles. It goes from Depot Park to the Concord Town Line. The original design included an at-grade crossing at Concord Road. The path was going to come up from the railroad right-of-way up to Concord Road, pass over, and then back down again, and MassDOT approved an underpass, so it's going to go under Concord Road.
I'm sorry, can you just remind everybody, for sure, those who might not have been there during that phase?
Sure.
That was MassDOT's suggestion based on safety. Was that what changed it from an at-grade to an underpass?
Yes. So the at-grade crossing, we looked at various scenarios using what's called a hawk signal or rapid rectangular, the RRFBs that you have in town, if it was at-grade. So if the trail came up to Concord Road, we looked at different types of crossing, protected crossings of the at road. When we talked to DOT about it, they suggested having an underpass under Concord Road for safety reasons. Yes.
Thank you.
And continuity. The project, as we had mentioned, starts at Depot Park. It extends along Railroad Ave. There's going to be a little bit of Commercial Ave that's reconstructed also to include some drainage improvements and roadway improvements. The bulk of the project is about 2 miles that's off-road right now. There's about 1,200 feet on Concord Road that will be reconstructed to install the underpass. This is the cross-section that we had discussed last year and for a few years. The path itself, this is on Railroad Ave, is going to include reconstructing the existing Railroad Ave for 2 10-foot lanes and 2 2-foot shoulders. It's going to also include improvements to the drainage system. Right now the drainage is poorly operating, so that's going to get reconstructed. A shared use path will be installed along the bike shop side of Railroad Ave. And a 4.5-foot wide cement concrete sidewalk will be installed on the opposite side of the roadway. The improvements will include traffic signal modifications, and the traffic signal equipment that's out at the intersection of South at Loomis Street will not change. It will be upgraded to include the bike path crossing at the intersection. There will be some timing changes. There'll be some equipment for that crossing themselves, but the mast arms and the signal heads, the posts that are there right now, will stay the way it is. It's just we're going to enhance it by adding a wider crosswalk and then some pedestrian amenities for that crossing. On Railroad Ave, as I had mentioned, the roadway will be reconstructed, the drainage will be reconstructed, a shared use path will be installed. At the corner where the curve that's going where the existing gravel parking lot is on Railroad Ave for people that use the existing unenhanced bike path, that is going to have an RRFB. We're looking at an enhanced crossing at that location. And the gravel parking lot right now will be reconstructed. We're going to do improvements to it and reconstruct the gravel so that it's more of a symmetric, more of a parking area instead of just a wide open lot.
Can I ask a question?
Yep.
I was just wondering if that reconstruction of the gravel area includes like moving the entrance?
The entrance will stay approximately the same location. What we'll be doing is better defining it so that it is a driveway apron instead of just an open area that you drive into. This is a very small graphic of Railroad Ave and what the improvements are. So starting at Depot Park, this is the roadway that's going to get reconstructed. I apologize for this, that this is what's going to happen at the intersection in terms of the crosswalk improvements and allowing for the traffic signal operations to include that crossing for the bike path. A shared use path will be installed on this side of Railroad Ave. As I said, the roadway is going to get reconstructed. Commercial Ave will be reconstructed to install part of the drainage system on Railroad Ave. The crossing itself will be included. This is going to be a protected crossing for the crosswalk and pedestrians on Railroad Ave. This is the entrance to the trail, and this is the gravel parking lot that I was just referring to.
So just really quickly, if you are here for the net zero presentation, that is not for another hour. And if you're here for Minuteman Bike, just so we can give people some space if they're here for this presentation, just to make some room. So if you're here for strictly for net zero, if we could just make some room for the folks that are here for Minuteman Bike. Net zero is on the agenda for 8. So just to, if people want to see who are here for this part of the presentation. That's all. Come on.
For the off-road section of the bike path, it's going to be 12 feet wide. It's going to be installed at the same spot where it's being used right now. It's just going to be formalized. It's going to be ADA compliant, which means that it's going to comply with federal standards for universal accessibility. There'll be 3-foot shoulders. They're going to be grassed, vegetated shoulders. So the actual paved surface on the rail bed will be 12 feet wide. There'll be railings installed at spots along the rail bed where the slope going down from the path itself gets steep, so we'll be putting in some protection so that people don't fall off of the trail and then go into either the wetlands or the surrounding streams and things like that. We're going to tie into the existing ground, so we're going to blend the proposed shoulders into the existing railroad embankment that's out there right now. And for the railroad, the off-road section, it's all within the railroad right-of-way. It's all within the property that's owned by the town.
There is one other major intersection at Hartwell Road. Is it planned to have stop signs on the trail?
There'll be stop signs on the trail. That's also going to have a protected crossing, so that's going to also have an RRFB. Just to go over this, the summary of what the project includes is a 12-foot wide path. The parking lots will be installed at Railroad Ave, what we just discussed, Lavender Lane, and also at Concord Road, there will be another parking lot. Trailheads will be installed at Railroad Ave on Concord Road and Wheeler Drive. There will be access and connections to existing pathways that connect into the railroad right-of-way right now. There'll be advanced warnings for crossings, for pedestrian crossings on Railroad Ave and Hartwell Ave. And there will be an underpass at Concord Road. Do you have another question?
No, I'm just trying to visualize the parking lot at Lavender Lane. Not that very much room there.
It'll be a small parking lot.
At the very end? At the very end?
Yeah. So this is the off-road section starting at the gravel driveway on Railroad Ave. This is Railroad Ave, the gravel parking lot. The trail will go on. This is an existing path that goes onto the trail or the railroad right-of-way right now. It'll follow the existing railroad right-of-way. There'll be a crossing and a protected crossing on Hartwell Ave. Again, I apologize for the graphic. This is Lavender Lane. There'll be a small parking lot installed there, and it'll cross under Concord Road and then end at the Concord Town Line. There will be a connection at Wheeler Road, which is right here, into the cul-de-sac. The parking area at Concord Road will be adjacent to the trail. It'll be accessible from the roadway right next to the underpass. This is just a blow-up of the underpass itself. So this is Concord Road. This is the underpass right here, and there's going to be a gravel parking lot that people can, there'll be a trailhead here also. People can park here and then access the trail behind the parking lot. So the next steps, as David had mentioned, the 25% public hearing will be later this spring. What that does is Mass DOT, as part of federal regulations, is required to hold a public hearing. They have documentation for it. It's facilitated by Mass DOT. They typically go through the right-of-way and talk about the project specifically, and then we'll be through a presentation and solicit public comments at that point. 75% design development will happen after the public hearing. There's a 30-day period for comments after the public hearing that will address any comments that are received at or after the public hearing will be addressed prior to commencement of the 75%. The right-of-way process will define what the right-of-way plans are based on the design at 75, but it's pretty much defined right now. And the environmental permitting will start at the 75%. So right now our schedule is projecting the completion of the project essentially in 2020. And although it's the program, the TIP program is 2022, so we'll be ahead of schedule for the construction.
And to be clear, all dates that we're talking about here, so as soon as the public hearing is scheduled, we'll make sure that it's fully advertised, that everyone has the opportunity, and then also set the timeline around, okay, there's 30 days from this point, so that everybody has ample opportunity to provide written or verbal comments.
Margaret?
Just want to confirm that this presentation is on the DPW website or someplace where people can go look at it in greater detail, because, yeah, it is really small. And that's okay. And I don't know if there are there other prior documents or things still up on the website other than this about the project? Because you're right, the history is long and deep.
I can provide the time
okay.
with all the presentations and PowerPoints from the previous meetings. The feasibility study?
They're up on our website now.
Okay, that's great. And I do know also that I think, believe the Citizen has reported on this in the past, and so perhaps there'll be a retrospective of how we got here.
Thanks in advance, Julie.
Lots of links.
Yes, Mike.
A question for some of the advocates here. Currently, Bedford Depot is a destination. When this is completed, something tells me that the town line is not going to be a destination. The destination is going to be is historic Concord. The unimproved railroad bed from the Concord line to Monument Street isn't bad. It's not going to be like this. So I wanted to ask the advocates here, do you know if there's any effort to persuade the town of Concord to follow our lead and try to work toward extending the Minuteman bike lane all the way to historic Concord?
Yes, Terry.
Well, I've just been waiting for Bedford to do their part. So, yes, they've been thinking about it for 10 years. They obviously wanted to do the Bruce Freeman first, which is now being completed, but yes, they're definitely thinking about it.
So that's good news. Although I suspect a lot of cyclists will find their way anyway to that destination.
So is there any other questions?
So right now the public hearing is scheduled for May, so there will be updates on the exact date, time, and location.
And can we just clarify, I remember when we did the Safe Routes to School project, the public hearing was actually conducted by Mass DOT.
That's right.
So this will be the same format where we'll essentially be there providing feedback to Mass DOT because this will be their project. Because I think that sometimes people that falls between the cracks a little bit, that once it was adopted onto the TIP, it becomes a Mass DOT project.
Right. Thank you.
Well, thank you for the presentation.
Thank you.
Thank you for reminding us where we are.
We're taking names now for to honor someone with the tunnel. someone with tunnel vision may get that award.
So our next item is a refuse and recycling contract.
Thanks, Trish.
We'll give you all a chance to leave if you don't want to be bored.
Thank you.
Sure. That would be at the public hearing that you'd have a chance to talk about that. Beg your pardon? There's not a date at this point, but you, Sarah?
Yes.
Would you answer this gentleman's question?
Sorry. Yep.
Is there a specific date? Not yet. I got a notice in the mail from the public works. I want to know whether I get another letter saying that the interviews come on board.
Comes in.
Have him come on down.
The mother's out here. Oh. David's right here.
That's yes, our recycling guru.
Ed.
Ed.
Right. Yep.
Come and join us up front, Ed.
I so want to talk about how there's papers all over the town.
All right, we need to get moving. Can I have a little quiet, please?
Need a gavel.
Yes. Ms. Stanton.
Okay, so before you this evening is the refuse and recycling contract. This has been before you three times. As I noted in the memorandum, this does include the increase to the 64-gallon toter, includes the amendments that were made in advance of the budget to reduce costs. It's a five-year contract, which is before you. So this is the fourth time that you'll be hearing it, and we're looking for your signature tonight so that we can move forward with the new contract effective July 1. There's also a significant lead time in ordering the toters, which is why we've taken so many meetings to talk about this. So before you tonight is the contract signing, which is right next to you with Caroline. Mm-hmm. David and Ed are here to answer any questions, but I know we beat this horse a little bit.
Perfect timing on a day that the streets are covered in papers.
Yes.
From the open bins.
Yep.
Mine were in a bag.
Oh, okay. So it shouldn't be.
Maybe you ought to just give us a quick verbal overview, even though we have it in front of us.
Yep, just briefly, as the town manager said, it's a five-year contract. It allows us to step up to the level of automated recycling and then recoup the costs of the investment of those carts over the five-year term. We look forward to having a slightly cleaner street line with these carts, as today showed some of the issues related to that. Also safer, also quicker, helps with traffic on those Mondays. We are staying with one day a week. We have the terms of the contractor such that it's contingent on annual appropriation funding, and so that's explicit in the contract you'll be signing. Ed and Regita Pirimetla, the assistant director, work very hard trying to put as much flexibility into this contract. As we've talked about, a lot of things changing in the recycling market, and how do we deal with trying to either segregate materials out that we can deal with more cost effectively separately, not only on the recycling side, but we're also starting to look on the refuse side, particularly related to food waste. So we've set a number of mechanisms into the contract to try to deal with these uncertain conditions as we move forward. Thank you.
Have you thought about what the process would be for a resident to have the option to get a smaller cart, please?
Yes, so with the cart size nominally is 64 gallon, but we'll work with people if they want to opt out of 64 to a smaller.
You imagine size. Them just calling you and asking you to do that?
Yep, so I think in other communities that have found success with this, if you found that the 64 gallon toter was too cumbersome for you to move, or a smaller toter would be more appropriate, then the DPW would trade out your larger toter with a smaller toter, or just deliver the smaller toter in the first place.
And we will, these items that we're paying them to take away, white goods and electronics, etc., we are charging an equal amount to town residents to ask for that service?
No.
Historically, we have not charged the residents for those items. One thing we are changing in this contract is we are asking to be charged separately by Republic to the town for these items so that we can more closely track the actual costs and the number of items that are being delivered. As we move forward, we have the flexibility, since it is being broken out from our base contract, that we could then in turn charge all or portion back to the residents for the service, fee for service.
And then one other question, and I'm sorry to dominate the questioning. What we have in front of us essentially is a base number, not including these special pickups, but volume can affect these numbers?
Correct.
And based on our history, how far below actual costs do you think these numbers are likely to be? Or do you think they're pretty accurate?
They're pretty
accurate. We've been projecting, so since the start of this fiscal year, I've been getting weekly reports from Republic on what they ship, what people call in to pick up on Monday as a bulk waste. And then on Wednesday is then the appliance, white goods selection, so I've been getting those. So we have a number, there's going to be some onus on Republic. The pushback we're going to have is when someone calls for a TV set, we need to know the size because there's a scheduled cost. So we have an idea, we've got an estimate. Fairly comfortable with it. I think we're in the ballpark. I don't think we're, I try to stay conservative with these projections, and so we've been, and I'm tracking them ongoing and getting the information as, you know, every week as we get it updated. So I think those costs are included in the, reflected in what's in the contract right now. We have an idea of what it's going to cost us and where we can, who we start, where the flexibility comes in. How do we handle electronic waste? Do we have public charges for it? I don't know the number, $10, $15. Or do we tell people bring it to Staples or Best Buy, where they can probably get rid of it for free? Or we eliminate it altogether and I do it in every 6 months at the recycling event. We bring it to the DPW. I mean, that's kind of the flexibility we have right now to see what happens. So
we feel pretty good about this contract in light of the number of times it's been before you and feedback internally and Regina and Ed working and David working so hard to get the numbers to be in a financially feasible approach. We feel very good about this contract.
Can I just ask a I don't know if this is just a page that got left off or if I'm missing something. In the food waste collection, where they're talking about the 6 to 10 locations for food waste collection at town and municipal buildings, it says it identifies a list of acceptable and non-acceptable items found in attachment J. There's an attachment I that says acceptable and non-acceptable items for food waste collection, but it's blank. So I'm wondering, is there a list and how will that information be conveyed to the users of those buildings? So I guess this is a question for Ed, just in terms of internal education once this contract goes into effect.
So we were looking, the public is looking to bring our third party in to do it, Black Earth Compost, the same company that's coming around to residents in town. That list should have been appended to that.
So you have it somewhere. Okay.
We still have a process relating to that. So we wanted to get, it was sort of an add-on or a nice to have as part of this contract. So we wanted to make sure that we got the contract terms done, the contract signed, the ability to order the toters, and then work with Black Earth on, okay, how do we educate? I mean, the fire station sort of said, hey, we're getting a compost bin. Was anyone going to tell us? And we said, no, it's a whole process and we'll talk to you. So I think the plan was to get the base of the contract done and then sort of work on the other items after.
Yeah. No, that's fine. I just wanted to make sure that it was just not something that had been left. I don't have any other questions.
Any other comments, concerns?
Nope.
Anybody in the audience care to ask anything?
Not at this point.
I think we're ready to.
Yeah.
I think we're ready to.
Yep.
So
I'm already grabbing them.
I would move that the selectmen approve the contract with Republic Services, as outlined in the memo of February 19th, for the contract, for the purposes of the contract motion, should I read out the amounts for each year?
No, you can approve the five-year.
As the five-year contract is outlined in the memo.
Yep, exactly, and the originals are being passed.
Get a second from Mike. All those in favor, say aye.
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 Any opposed? Motion is carried 5-0-0.
For the contract.
And thank you for, I'm sure, the hours that got spent in putting this together. Thank you, Ed.
Thank you, Bill.
Thank you.
So, we want to, we have 8 o'clock on here. Do we want to wait?
I think this is the audience for Net Zero. I'm guessing there's a lot of matching t-shirts, so I want to give away.
O'clock, people might be still coming.
We could wait till 8 if people want to wait till 8 and do other items beforehand.
Well, why don't we skip to the issue concerning Willow Lane?
Sure. So before you is the acceptance of plan layout relating to Willow Lane. As you know, the street acceptance is on the town meeting warrant article for March. As part of the legal ease associated to it, it's a two-step process. The first step is before you tonight, which is to accept the plan layout, which is included in a memorandum in your packets. Essentially, you've already done this by agreeing to put it on the warrant, but legally, the selectmen have to approve step one. Step two is the next meeting on March 11th, which is a public hearing to formally accept the plan layout. All the materials are included in your packet. Kudos to Catherine Perry, who put together a very comprehensive memo outlining all of the background associated to it, all of the legal work done by our legal counsel at MHTL, also by legal counsel representing Willow Lane. So it's the selectmen to vote to accept the plan layout as before you and vote to essentially move on to step two, which is notification of abutters, which we will do tomorrow, who are abutters, I think it's 4 people in total, and then the public hearing set for March 11th. I didn't think it was necessary for Catherine to attend in light of how comprehensive her memo was.
I find it fascinating, the terminology is to lay out the road when it's been laid out for how long?
It's a little backwards in light of the fact that you, every board has voted to put forward the street acceptance on the warrant, which is the declaration that you are agreeing to do this. But in light of that, there are still two sort of housekeeping-like steps. Jenny has the paperwork that she can circle around, which is considered Form 2, which will be shortly followed by Form 3 to go from there.
We can any form.
Yes, so if you will vote to accept the plan layout, we can pass for your signature.
Any questions?
The motion as written here?
Yep.
So, does it include the parenthetical for?
Yes.
I recommend that the selectmen vote on their own initiative and based upon the recommendation of the public works engineer and the planning director that they intend to lay out a townway at Willow Lane in the cluster subdivision formerly known as Gregory Drive, and that notice of this intention be served on the owner and abutters of the land that will be acquired for this purpose.
Second. And second from Ed. Any other discussion? All those in favor, please say aye.
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 Aye. Aye. Opposed? No abstaining. It's 5-0-0.
So things to come, we will notify the abutters tomorrow, and a public hearing is scheduled for, I think, 8:15 on your March 11th meeting.
Somebody tell Gregory.
We will tell him.
We don't have a student.
Should we do our miscellaneous action item?
Sure, yep, I could do that, and then we'll do minutes in the town manager's report since we have some time. So the Foray is a common victualer's license for Aramark at RSA Security. Compass Dining is no longer providing services to RSA Security. Aramark is the new service provider, so this is the paperwork to reflect their change in application. All paperwork is in line, everything is set.
I move the selectmen approve a common victualer's license for Aramark providing services at RSA Security at 174 Middlesex Turnpike.
Second. Caroline second. All those in favor, please say aye.
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 Motion's carried 5-0.
You have minutes before your executive and regular session for February 11, 2019. If you have substantial edits, please make note and forward to Jenny for executive session. We can't discuss an open session. If not, they are ready for approval.
So we'll start with the executive session. Anybody, any changes that they feel can be made at this time? Hearing none? Oh, I'm sorry, Ed does?
Yeah, I'll just hand him to.
Okay, and we will deal with this on another occasion. The next item is the regular session of Monday, February 11.
Wait a minute.
Everybody good?
What is this? Hold on.
Yep. No panic.
I meant to do this yesterday. February. Is that, okay, yeah. Sorry.
Okay.
Are you good?
Yeah.
I don't have any corrections.
Then let's have a motion.
I move the selectmen approve the regular session minutes of Monday, February 11th, 2019.
Second.
Second from Ed.
No, wait a minute.
Take your book away.
19-167. The Navy hangar's not at Hanscom Air Force.
It's at Hanscom.
It's adjacent to Hanscom Field. Yeah, I think that's an important consideration.
I amend my motion.
Sorry.
So close.
I have to amend my second then.
There you go.
As amended.
I'm jet lagged, sir.
All righty. All those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Motion's carried 500.
401. I was in here.
Oh, 401. I'm sorry. Thank you. So, why don't we? I don't think we have any choice but to go back unless you want us to do your report now.
I mean,
it's not going to fill 20 minutes.
Yeah,
time.
I can't. I don't think it will fill 40 minutes. I would.
We have the appointments to make.
Strongly that you want to wait another 25 minutes. Way ahead of schedule. Now. Okay.
Talk amongst yourselves.
Great.
Come on down.
So before you this evening is Dan Bostwick, Chair of the Energy and Sustainability Committee, who's providing an update on the net zero initiatives relating to updates on the committee, overall next steps. Dan will periodically be here to update us from time to time on the good work being done by the committee, so he has a presentation this evening. Does he have a presentation this evening? He does have a presentation this evening, but it's going to go up on the screen. So, Dan, if you want to lead us off.
Yeah, so I'm going to... As town manager said, I'm here to give you an update on the net zero planning process that was a result of the town meeting vote in November of last year, 2 years ago, to fund a net zero plan for Bedford. I'm also going to talk a little bit about the Better Building Codes campaign, because I understand there were some selectmen who had some questions about that. So we've completed phase one. The net zero planning process was from October of last fall until this February. During this phase, our consultant developed an energy inventory to provide a baseline for Bedford's greenhouse gas emissions. And we also established some working groups that held meetings to brainstorm strategies for reducing greenhouse gas emissions and developing an initial action list. Currently, between now and mid-April, our consultant is taking the list of strategies and actions and doing some modeling and analysis to determine how effective those actions would be at reducing gas emissions and coming up with more detail on how they may be implemented in Bedford. Then in mid-April, we'll reconvene our working groups to review the analysis of our consultant and prioritize those strategies. And we'll begin engaging the public through public meetings with the goal of presenting a final plan to the selectmen in July, and then all we have to do is implement it. So as I said, the first thing that happened was our consultant developed an energy inventory that characterizes Bedford's current greenhouse gas emissions, where they're coming from, and what the state of are in Bedford currently. I forwarded you the entire report. I'm not going to go through it all here. It's also available on the town website for anybody who wants to look at it. I'm just going to touch on a couple of highlights. One is that contrary to statewide trends, Bedford's electric use and emissions have been increasing in the past few years. And this is a bit of a challenge for us because the state spends a lot of effort and money getting a 2% decrease, and we're going up. So we have we're going in the wrong direction. As suggested by the chart on the right, most of this is driven by non-residential activity. And you'll see on the next slide that about 75% of the greenhouse gas emissions generated by buildings in Bedford are from non-residential sources. And these are primarily commercial and industrial sources. The municipal sector doesn't play a huge role here. A couple of things to notice about this chart. One is that about half of the emissions are from electric use, from the generation of electricity that's used in our buildings, which is encouraging because as the regional grid becomes greener, then we'll sort of naturally get a decline in emissions through electric use. The other thing to note is that, you know, it's not very many properties, about 273 properties that account for about 75% of the emissions from Bedford, which to one of our consultants was a positive thing because he said, oh, we just have to fix 273 buildings, and we're all set. So one of the surprising things from this inventory was that this emissions profile of 75% non-residential versus 25% residential looks a lot more like Cambridge than it does our next-door neighbors such as Lexington or Concord or Prelog. So that was more like a mini Cambridge in terms of, probably this is the only way we're like mini Cambridge, but we're like mini Cambridge in terms of an emissions profile.
I don't know if I'd go that far as someone that worked in Cambridge, but yes. I'd take their tax base.
Okay, yeah. So as I said, after the inventory, we convened an advisory council of stakeholders from across the town. We had elected officials, we had town staff, we had business partners, people from the larger community, realtors, builders, architects, some private citizens who work in the energy efficiency industry, some members of advocacy groups such as Mothers Up Front. And the goal of this council, as you know, as I stated earlier, was to develop some initial strategies and brainstorm some ideas on how we might reduce greenhouse gas emissions in Bedford. And at our first advisory council meeting at the end of October, we formed three working groups, one for municipal, residential, and commercial, where each working group could zero in on their particular sector. And then we alternated between meetings of the full advisory council and then the individual working groups, so that those ideas that were brainstormed at the working group level could be then discussed among the whole group. So between October and February, we had three full advisory council meetings, and each of the working groups met three times. And we framed all of our discussion around four concepts. Sort of the mantra of net zero planning is report, reduce, produce, and purchase. So you need to report to know how you're making progress. You need to know how buildings are performing. And then in order to reduce emissions, you want to both reduce the energy that is being used by buildings and then produce local green energy. And then the purchase part is an acknowledgement that you're likely not going to meet your goal through reduce and produce alone. You have to purchase some green energy. Now the next three slides, I'm going to show you some of the strategies that we brainstormed for each of the sectors. But I want to point out that this is still really at the brainstorming stage, that these aren't in any way detailed plans. A lot of them are going to require a lot more thought in terms of how it's implemented, and some of them may drop off and more ideas may come on. In the residential sector, we recognize that there is a lot of existing money out there in the state programs for reducing energy in homes. And just like the Mothers Up Front campaign that's going on now to encourage residents to get home energy assessments, we think there's opportunity for additional targeted campaigns to further encourage participation in these programs. One example might be a campaign encouraging people to install air source heat pumps specifically in neighborhoods of Bedford where there's no natural gas. People are burning fuel oil now. And encourage them to go straight to electric heating and cooling rather than going to another fossil fuel. In the reporting category, we think perhaps we should advocate for a state requirement that a home's energy performance be provided as part of the listing for a home when it's offered for sale. this is actually something that the governor has agreed to in principle, but the real estate industry has convinced him to slow track it a little bit because they're not a big fan of this, even though in other parts of the country this is shown to, you know, reduce time to sale and even increase home prices. And finally, community choice aggregation is a wonderful tool that can enable a town to reduce its greenhouse gas emissions by purchasing green energy. And Bedford is in the process of beginning its first greenhouse, aggregation plan. However, that plan is just for 5% additional green energy above the state requirement. And so we would encourage, you know, we think that the next time that we go out to bid for the second or another plan, we would want to increase the amount of green energy. Some other towns in Massachusetts are getting 50, 60, or even 100% green energy, still being cheaper than the resource basic rate. Now, in terms of the municipal sector, there are a lot of good things going on in the municipal sector, and I think one of the roles that the municipal sector can play is to be an example, is to lead by example. So we should be publicizing and building on things that we're already doing. So for example, I believe the town's next energy purchase plan is 25% green energy and saving the town money. The addition that's being designed for John Glenn Middle School has a design goal of not adding to the energy consumption of the school. So it's going to be essentially a net zero addition. So these are the types of things that the town should be publicizing so that other people see what's possible. Another possible strategy would be to establish an energy revolving fund where savings from energy can be plowed back into future energy efficiency investments rather than just going into the general fund. And perhaps even funding some additional staff, like a sustainability director. The last idea here on the municipal page is a little bit further out there. We recognize that there are many big important town buildings all within spitting distance of each other here on the town campus. And so what would it look like to have a microgrid where this town campus was sort of isolated in terms of electricity? There's certainly some efficiencies to be gained there, but it also would be a great thing on a very windy day when power is out over many places in town to have the essential town services still be able to function without interruption. I'm not actually suggesting that they cover the ball fields with solar panels. This is just a little diagram to help you understand. And finally, in the commercial sector, on the report side, there's this idea of requiring large users of energy to report their use to the town and have that disclosed publicly. Now, this is something that has been done in many communities around the country, and it would allow the town to understand how this sector that is contributing most of the greenhouse gases is making progress towards our goals. Now, of course, there's a lot of detail to be worked out here, and we probably want to start with a voluntary pilot program, which I think is feasible because we did a lot of head nods when this came up in the commercial working group. And there are also, of course, implications on town staff, you know, who's going to receive this data and what are we going to do with it. This is an important tool. Then more broadly, you know, what regulatory changes can the town enact to encourage on-site generation of clean energy or more efficient building construction? This is sort of inspired by Watertown's recent the bylaw or ordinance to require solar panels on new large commercial construction. And, you know, is something like that appropriate here in Bedford? Or can we modify our zoning bylaws to encourage solar canopies over parking lots? Or can we restructure our building permit fees to encourage people, you know, people that are doing, you know, more efficient construction can get a break on their fees, things like that. And then finally, similar to CCA, but community choice aggregation is not typically appropriate for commercial buildings because they go out and get their own power purchase agreements. But we think there may be opportunity for either or companies to come together as a larger buying groups or larger companies to provide expertise and information to smaller companies that may not have the staff and the resources to go out and get the cleanest, cheapest energy. So that's just a brief overview of some of the strategies we've developed in our first phase. The last two slides I have talk about the Better Building Codes campaign, which is relevant because the goal of the campaign is to increase the energy efficiency in buildings. Specifically, the goal, this is a national campaign, but in Massachusetts, it's being run by NAPC and the Northeast Energy Efficiency Partnerships over here in Hartwell, and the Sierra Club, and the Massachusetts Climate Action Network. The idea is to get as many eligible voters registered to vote on the next version of the International Energy Conservation Code.
Is this not sort of a separate subject?
It is kind of a separate subject.
Maybe we ought to just stick with net zero and talk about this code under at a different occasion.
Okay.
I think you and Ms. Stanton had talked about this earlier.
Yeah, so we did. Yeah. Dan and I did talk about it earlier. As you know, those that enforce the IECC code are those that are eligible to vote on the IECC code. And those that are enforcing said code are not part of the political lexicon. So right now it's Chris Lasky, who is our chief code inspector and building inspector, our fire chief, our fire prevention officer, and another member of the building department. And so that process, very keenly, is sort of considered to be apolitical. They stay out of the fray. They're happy to be educated. Dan and I talked about how do we share materials with them? How do we make sure they're as well-informed as possible? But under the law, Bedford has four folks that vote. Now, if we had a much larger code department or a much larger fire department, in many communities, their votes aren't even quite enough, considering how large their staff are that vote on this. In Bedford, we're a little bit smaller. We punch above our weight class, but we only have four folks that are eligible to vote. And I had said to Dan, please forward all information to share with them. But as you can imagine, the fire chief and the code enforcement director go at lengths to stay out of the advocacy world per the advice of our legal counsel and per who they are as people. So I had said to Dan, you know, they're happy to take information on, but their role in this sort of conversation is please share information, but we're staying out of the fray.
But we do have those votes populated by the appropriate people.
Yes,
is the answer
so.
To the
yeah,
so
absolutely.
I think the original question was, did we have all of our votes? And we have all our votes.
Yep.
So that's the cut and dry.
And they're all registered. Dan emailed to say just to make sure that they were registered and ready to go, and they are registered and ready to vote. And as you know from working with those folks, they're happy to get as much information as possible to make sure that they're enforcing the most informed decision, what's best for Bedford.
I just want to take a moment just to thank Dan and Emily Prince, also, who I don't think is here this evening, who are the co-chairs of this Net Zero Advisory Council. And it's been a lot of work, and it's been a big project to undertake. And I think they have really brought a lot of energy, no pun intended, a lot of energy to the table. And also, if you look through the report from Peregrine Energy, it also has a list of all the other participants. And although not every individual participated in every meeting, I just wanted to note that we did have representatives from a broad cross-section of the town. And I think the challenge going forward will be to keep folks engaged and to continue to do outreach to, particularly to our commercial community about this, because I do know that there's always concern, you know, about what will the town be requiring of us, or what will come with some new bylaw change. And I think the posture that the working groups all had was working in the direction of the efficiencies that already exist. Many of these larger property owners already have energy managers, sort of like Taseer's counterparts. A lot of them do their energy procurement. A lot of them are already using software that is available from the federal government to track their energy usage. So the idea is to try to work as collaboratively as possible and to make sure that the messaging is all about us doing things that are mutually beneficial, both environmentally and also financially, obviously, for the property owners. And as Dan mentioned, with our energy, our electricity rates going up, that may be something that's tied to the economy and the upturn of the economy. And we do have manufacturings, we've got lab, we have data centers, we have all sorts of stuff, as Dan said, that our neighbors don't, and that is does make us a little bit more like Cambridge. If you look in the energy inventory, you'll see that our profile is a little bit more to that side. So it's been a great project and very interesting, and I just wanted to take a moment to thank all the people who had been involved.
I did have a question as I was reading this. The use of electricity, for instance, has gone up in the commercial area and industrial area, but we don't know exactly what the electricity is being used for. I assume a lot of it's just plain lighting
That's true. We don't have really per building usage data from the utility. It's just aggregate data that, you know, these are commercial accounts and this is how much energy they use. We don't really have a way.
Do you think we ultimately will have a way to find out?
Well, if we institute a building energy use disclosure bylaw, then certainly. If it's voluntary or compulsory, then that would be an excellent way to get that kind of data.
Because if it's lighting, you know, what jumps to your mind immediately is something like LEDs,
right,
and retrofitting,
right,
all of that.
Right.
And I'm sure there'd be significant savings then.
Yep.
So I think just as with our municipal, as we've learned through the process of being a green community, some of the things are kind of baked into the systems. So you're talking about the HVAC systems and large ticket items, so that what you want to do is get into the hearts and minds of the people who are making the purchasing for the large, long, you know, those things with long shelf life. And then some of those things are behavioral. Do people leave their computers on when they leave work, and could they turn them off, right? Are there ways to make, sometimes you're running an experiment, you can't turn off the power. But there are ways to encourage some discernment about what is absolutely mission critical if you're talking about either a town or a commercial building, and what's the background noise of just people being careless because they're really not, if you're the tenant in this building, if you're working in a building, you're not being exposed to the consequences of your leaving that light switch or that computer on.
Possibly,
all night.
The other thing, though, on the positive side, it might represent more businesses coming to town and being active, which is in some ways a very positive thing.
That's right.
So it would probably be good to the extent that we can ultimately find out, so we can make corrections in the right areas.
Right.
Is your council talking at all about the possibility of monitoring or influencing commercial energy use on a regional basis?
No, we haven't. We've been focusing on Bedford.
I mean, if there are other groups in other places.
I'm not sure exactly what you mean.
Well, I mean, if there are other groups like yours in other towns that are contiguous, and I'm sure there are.
Yes, there are in Lexington and Concord, for sure.
You know,
it'd be great if there were in Burlington.
I mean, there should be. Maybe something like the bylaw changes that are suggested. You know, we don't want towns saying, come and build here because we don't have an onerous bylaw.
Right.
Well, also, I mean, I think Dan touched on this as well, that there are ways, and as our planning department is looking at our zoning bylaws, for example, there are ways that you could look at and think about things that would incentivize people towards the behavior that we wanted them. And I think that solar parking canopies or, you know, different, you know, some trade-off between allowable FAR for a net zero building, things like that, that are within our power to construct and to make it desirable to a potential property owner, so that it's not just, feeling as though we're going to put ourselves at some competitive disadvantage by requiring that our buildings be more energy efficient. In many instances, when people are coming and rehabbing our office space, they are doing a lot of those things anyway. And if we make it more attractive and easier and clearer, especially, you know, we're going to appoint our charter and bylaw review committee, the clarity of our bylaws and how explicit we are in saying what it is that we are trying to ask people to do or require to do can be very helpful to a property owner. So I don't see it as all downside that somehow if we put in some changes in our bylaw that we're automatically going to be at a competitive disadvantage with our neighbors if we do it in a thoughtful way.
Ed?
Oh, yeah, and I suppose that's the part of it, is the thoughtful way to put it in, because you know, the commercial sector subsidizes the rest of us for a tune of about 25%, which is a nice, you know, nice little discount, if you will, on the tax rate. There's a lot of information here, and which is great for me. The one thing that you mentioned, the 2% each year for like the last three, I think, although the last one's zero.
Right.
We have had a lot of lab space come in. Mm-hmm. And to me, I think lab space is a different user. So when we look at this, is there a way to drill down into how much actual square footage has gone to lab space the last two or three years? Just as a, you know, a kind of a confirmation of what's happening in Bedford. I know we compare to Cambridge,
right,
on one of your charts.
Right.
And I couldn't help but think that, you know, we, on the other side, we want the lab space because it's a lot of new equipment, which is a lovely new growth number that comes out of,
right,
of the, for the taxes. So it's like a double-edged sword. I want the lab, but they produce that they're using or consuming a lot of electricity,
right,
or potentially, or you know, whatever they're doing. So I'm just curious if that is what is driving the increase.
Yeah, I can ask our consultant who may, he got the assessor's database, and he may be able to tell. And I can also talk to the economic development director, see mm-hmm. if she has any information about restriction of that information.
We also have manufacturing, which is something that I don't think a lot of people realize, that
right,
we have manufacturing. And obviously, if there's a bigger market for some widget, as I said, and they're making more widgets, they're going to likely be using more electricity. So that's, again, why the tie to the economic drivers. But I think there also are a lot of a lot of sort of small to mid-sized businesses that could probably benefit from mm-hmm. helping with procurement, helping access opportunities to do just the same kind of energy audits that we do with our homes, to get at those that some of that low-hanging fruit that is not going to impact their mission critical systems. So, but I agree. I think that some of that information is available in the assessor's database. Sometimes there are mixed uses within one
mm-hmm.
building. It's a little harder to tease out. So it's not like there's one-stop shopping for finding out this information, but it is something that our consultants have been looking into.
Yeah, at least they would have the new lab space and the new development profiles of businesses that have come into town. So if it's existing, it's always a little bit trickier on the assessor's
right.
database to break out the different uses, but Elisa has the profile of every
the new
business
people.
That's come in since she's been
mm-hmm.
here.
Yeah.
Dan, does your group have a specific next action that you're focusing on?
The first line.
Of the net zero group?
Yeah.
So we're waiting for our consultants to finish their modeling and analysis of these strategies and more. And we'll reconvene the advisory council in mid-April. And we're going to look at that analysis and start prioritizing the strategies of which ones we think the town should go after first, you know, and which ones maybe scheduled for later because we can't do everything at once, to lay out a schedule.
Mm-hmm. Dan, would you imagine August or July for our meeting as a follow-up date as a result of the report or earlier?
To the selectmen?
Yeah.
July, you know, we would want to present the final thing. I'm happy to come in at any time, perhaps after a couple of advisory council meetings in May, and tell you where we're thinking in terms of prioritization.
Okay. Any other questions or concerns? Mm-hmm. We'll look forward to your continued progress. I think it's terrific.
Thank you.
Thanks, Dan.
So,
definitely not his first.
I think we're sort of reached the end of our agenda, except for your report and the contract.
And also the committee appointments from tonight, so the Charter and Bylaw Review Committee appointments, I'd like to do that as well.
Oh, I'm sorry, I wasn't here, so
no, that's okay.
I will...
We could do that last, and you could go home.
Sure, so I just want to give an update on a couple things. So before you tonight are out selectmen's meetings until May 6th. So I've been including in your packets four meetings, give or take, of upcoming agenda items. The old Bill Ricker Road update, the housing study and review, which is for next week's meeting, town meeting article assignments, You'll also see liaison assignments, the creation of the Hartwell Road Ad Hoc Committee, which I know Mike is anxious to get started, and then some contracts. So you'll see that there's holds on the out meetings, but I just wanted to draw everyone's attention to some of these upcoming meetings, just so that you know what's coming down the line. We've also put some holds in meetings for June for the ambulance rates. We've put some holds for water and sewer rates and a whole litany of items. So in anticipation of those meetings coming and materials also forthcoming, I wanted to give a heads up about that. Also before you tonight is the police chief's contract we talked about in previous executive sessions. I think we're all excited that the chief has agreed to stay on board. This contract has been reviewed by legal counsel, both by the police chief and by our internal labor counsel, Leo Pelliquin. The contract is for 5 years, so we are extending our already successful marriage with the chief for another 5. I asked him, I told him he did not have to come tonight. He has twin 3-year-olds, and he was supposed to be later on the agenda. So he is home, but I know he's very excited to be on board.
I already grabbed the contract, I guess.
He's very excited to be on board for, I'm very excited that he's going to be on board for another 5 years. I think he's very excited to be on board for another 5 years. So I'm happy to answer any questions about the contract, but if signed tonight, it would go into place July 1. The chief would be here for another 5 years.
And you need us move to confirm your appointment of him?
Yes. And then for the sign contract. For his contract extension.
I'm happy to make that motion unless anybody has any questions about the contract.
No. Please.
Okay, I move that the selectmen confirm the appointment of Robert Buongiorno as our police chief for the next 5 years per the agreement that has been presented to us by the town manager.
Second.
Any other discussion? All those in favor, please say aye.
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 The motion is carried. Well done, Ms. Hunton.
Yeah, I know he's pretty excited. I am too. Another piece of hot information off the presses, we officially have a disclosed high bidder for the Navy hangar. Charles Patzios has been identified by the GSA as the awarded high bidder. He's currently going through the 60-day deed process. Charles is currently doing work of the redevelopment of the GE site in Lynn and also the Lynn commuter rail site as well. I've had the opportunity to talk to some folks from the city of Lynn who've had very positive things to say about Mr. Patzio, so I am cautiously optimistic about the next steps ahead of us. We have quite a bit of work to be done, but as the bidder is public, I wanted to make sure that everyone else knew that the bidder was public. Certainly more to come, but that is step one. Disclosure. That's it on my end, Bill.
That's your report?
Yep.
Anything you'd like to say, madam?
I don't have any liaison reports. This is officially my last meeting. I say that with fixed emotions. Obviously, it's been a wonderful 6 years, and I will be on that side many occasions, heckling when appropriate, heckling when appropriate. But it's been a wonderful, wonderful time serving with all of you, and that's all.
Well, we certainly appreciate your having been here.
Yeah, thank you.
Thank you, Margot.
Well, I'll just echo that. I'll just say what a privilege it's been to serve with you, and that we'll miss you, but we'll look forward to the heckling.
Okay.
And
it's us, it's you.
And I know where the VCC website is and where vacancies are, so I won't be gone for long.
Yeah, and the 6 years have passed by sort of shockingly quickly.
Yes, yes. Good thing we're all getting younger.
Yeah. So just a couple things. This is kind of a ZBA / planning board update. ZBA will be hearing an application from Posto on Thursday night. I hope to be in attendance. I know the town manager may...
The code enforcement director and
code enforcement.
Economic development director.
Okay, excellent. So just to refresh everybody's memory, we have conditionally granted them the change in their liquor license for the Camilla's site, and they want a larger restaurant. And so they have a few more steps to go through, including the ZBA and including town meeting. So tomorrow night, the planning board will be having the public hearing for the change, the slight alteration and the change in allowable restaurant size.
Which would apply not just to be clear, not just,
To this, right. But it's kind of, this is all, these are all like the little steps in a row. So I will be there hopefully I don't know if I'll be there tomorrow night, but I'll definitely be there on Thursday night. And I just want to be able to just sort of go forward with our unequivocal support for this restaurant, that our town staff has done a lot of legwork to attract to town. And I really want to make sure that they'll be feeling like they have the support of the town leadership, because I believe that they do. So I just wanted to alert you all to that in case any of you would like to attend with me.
Oh. Very good. Anything else on your docket?
Just as a side note, where are we with liquor licenses? Do we have?
You still have quite a few.
We have as many.
We have the new ones that we got, the home rule petition ones. I think we only issued a couple of them, one or two. Yeah. The original 14, I think, are all spoken for, but we got 8 in the end, right? So we have 7.
So no issue in doing this?
Yeah, no, we don't have any. We're not up against the limit.
Michael?
Police and fire will be represented at Thursday night's meeting of the Hanscom Area Towns Committee in a round table with public safety leaders from Massport and the Air Force Base. There should be some interesting exchanges, particularly in the area of anticipated development on what they call the north ramp, the north side of the runway, and which is on the Bedford boundary, and whose role it is and how we're going to allocate that. I'll be there if anybody else can be there. I have a personal conflict that I will be able to navigate if I can't get any backup, but I do have commitments from our own public safety leaders that they'll be represented, which is good. I wanted to mention, is following up to the town manager's announcement about the high bidder, that just to make sure everybody understands that the fact that we know who the bidder is does not change our earlier statement that we're looking at all the options that might be available to us in the context of the future of that property. Following the Attorney General's decision. Also wanted to thank Caroline for 6 years with this group and all of her prior service. You got so much more ahead of you to contribute to the quality of life in and out of government. So we'll look forward to this partnership and maybe a third generation.
Maybe. She's still in high school, we'll see.
It's never too early to plant the seed. Mm.
Edward. Yeah, I don't have anything to add other than, Caroline, it's been a pleasure working with you, and I'm sure we'll keep the dogs barking somewhere. You got off without that.
Yeah.
And this is the last meeting before town election and reorganization, so I want to thank all of you for the honor and pleasure and duty of serving as your selectman chair for the last year. You've all been great support, and we had a very busy year this year. We found ourselves a wonderful new town manager, and that was an easy process.
For me and for you.
Yes, right. And we've had a few things going on with hangers, and so I want to thank you all for your service, and I am up for re-election, as you all know, so I'm hoping I will be back here to join you for the next meeting, but we'll know more on March 9th. I did recuse myself earlier from dealing with appointing people to the Charter Commission because my wife is one of the contestants, so I will recuse myself again as you discuss it, but we will be talking. Thank you.
So that only item I just wanted to bring up in light of the Charter and Bylaw Review Commission member is that one of the folks that have applied is general counsel for our auditing firm. So I wanted to get a formal legal opinion from town council of whether or not that's considered to be a conflict of interest. Clifton Larson Allen is who does our annual audit, but that's the only sort of identified conflict we wanted to bring up.
Can I also just reference that we did get the memo from Bruce Murphy concerning the presence of an assessor on the charter review?
Yeah, so Bruce teaches on Monday evening, so he was unable to be here. In light of the fact the reorganization of the Board of Assessors is a pressing matter specifically related to the charter review, Bruce asked that he be taken under consideration even though he couldn't be here tonight to advocate for himself. So he did put together a statement of interest that's included in your packets.
I'd like to suggest that we consider appointing all of the applicants. I realize it would be an even number. That wasn't the original thought. I know that I would have a hard time excluding any single one of them. That is still a possibility with the awaiting the decision on the conflict.
I would advocate against an even number if we could. One person I did think of this evening that I should have thought to call earlier was Brian O'Donnell, who worked for the Office of Attorney General and Inspector General for a million years.
He was in the audience briefly
earlier. Yes, he was, which I was like, you know.
We could have asked him.
But I don't know, Kathy, is there an issue if it's an even number?
I'm not so sure that it's legally a problem, but I think that it can always be an issue when you have an even number instead of an odd number.
Yeah.
I also, in light of the question that you asked earlier, Mike, while we do want to move this right along, it's possible that if you waited though, then Caroline would, then you.
We had it interviewed without, yeah.
Right.
Oh, I mean, I
could wait to appoint, is what I'm saying, or you could appoint.
Yeah.
Some of them, and then continue to the next meeting.
Sorry, Kathy. Is Bob being sincere in his withdrawal?
I think so.
And he had stepped away from all committee work a couple of years ago. He had just sort of set himself a deadline of not doing it anymore. But it seems as though he got swept off his feet by the town manager. I would take him at his word that he doesn't wish to be considered.
He could be the seventh, and then we
know. You could also do the sixth and then shoot for a seventh member. You could do the sixth now and then see if you can get a seventh person.
The conflict issue,
unless he's doing direct counsel work for our auditors, I don't know how far that conflict of interest would go. Mm-hmm. I don't know.
I don't think that a change to, I would be nervous about any change to the charter or bylaws that was recommended by one vote. Really, like 5-4, you know, we're.
You're probably right.
I'm not sure that would carry it, tell me.
So it's a 9-member board.
Traditionally.
So if you went to 10, or let's say if you went to 11, if you wanted to drag one more person into it, then it's
And I'm not available quite yet.
And that's a 6-person quorum. It starts, that's what worries me more than the number of the votes. It's the quorum, because you want everybody there, obviously, but you do wind up sometimes having the situations where you have a large committee and then you can't get your quorum. I think
with this group, fully invested in lots of history of being on committees and boards, I think.
Yeah.
That would be less of an issue, maybe?
I mean, you got the selectmen, the planning board, the school committee, and the moderator. There's four right there that, you know, it's almost like their job to.
We could always toss in an extra. We can toss in an extra selectman or an extra planning board member. I really like the idea of having some newer people on it, because the fact is, the next time we go around, we want people who are experienced, and we don't want a whole crew of newbies who've never done it before. I think people need to learn these ropes, and they have the world's best teachers. They have the people who wrote the charter, and Betsy, who's been on practically every charter review committee since inception, so.
And I will say, just for the newbies sticking their hand up to be denied, it's just a bad taste for somebody who wants to volunteer, and I think, you know, this is a way to get to know the town at the constitution level, to your point, right? Which is the place that you want to learn it from. So I agree, I think.
So what I, you know, Mike, if you want us to consider approving all of them and
leaving
maybe
a spot open with the BCC,
potentially leaving a spot open for an extra selectman, and then if we hear back that there is any problem with John, we can just fix that after the fact.
Well, can you ask on the other side? It may be a conflict. He may have a, the auditors may have a conflict, right?
He may have a problem with his job more than we have a problem with him.
So we can appoint everybody but John, and then make a separate motion contingent?
Well, I'll start by moving that the selectmen appoint Kathy Cordes as a town moderator member of the Charter and Bylaw Review Committee for a term ending June 30th, 2020, because that's easy.
You can do the slate. You can do all the
second.
Yeah. All right. In that case, then I will add on to that slate Carol Amick, Betsy Anderson, Maria Barino, Bruce Murphy, Jan Shepherd.
Second.
That's it. There we go.
Anyone?
Second.
Moved by Margaret, seconded by
Ed. I thought you were seconding. I forgot to
look. I was asking for a second.
Yeah.
Just getting practice. okay, all those in favor of the slate?
Aye.
Aye. 401. 400.
Bill's not here. And so then I'll make a motion to provisionally appoint John Shutkin to the Charter and Bylaw Review Committee for a term ending June 30th, 2020, pending review by Town Council.
Second.
Moved by Margaret, seconded by Caroline. For the conditional appointment, all those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. 400. When should we make...
Town moderator has a question.
Catherine?
Yeah, I'm going to ask the same thing you're about to ask. Do you have the names for school committee, planning board, and
March 11
yet?
March 11th, so everything wanted to be done after the election.
Yeah.
Yep.
Yeah, I guess that makes sense.
Yeah. Yep.
So March 11th, and then the first meeting can be March 12th.
Probably not.
Yeah.
I don't think we can post it and have that meeting quite that fast.
Any further business for the selectmen?
I move we adjourn.
Second.
Moved by Margaret, seconded by Caroline. All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. 400. Thank you all.
Thanks,
I'll just
Mike.
Take my chair. And